I geared this talk a little bit because a little bit in the way that many of you are students still and at community college, and that's where I started out something like 35 years ago. I was sitting in a chair not unlike yours, just starting out my sort of education. I went back to school a little bit later. I'm from Connecticut and New York City originally, but I was living in California and painting houses for a living, that and alternately swinging a hammer and doing construction and stuff. And I started going to community college there because it was in California, it was free, $5 in books when I first started. By the time I left, it was $50 in books, but it's still a pretty good deal. so I started going to school there, and a couple of terrific professors that I had there let me know that, in fact, I'd always been interested in art, and I've been photographing since I was like 12 years old, and a couple of great teachers there let me know that it was in fact possible to make a life for oneself as an artist, right? That it always seemed sort of impossible to me that one could actually go out. And of course, everybody tells you that it's really hard to do, right? Yes, it's hard to be an artist. It's hard to spend your life that way, but it's no harder than being a contractor or a lawyer or any of those things. You still have to put in long days and long hours at any of those jobs to sort of make things happen. But I kind of feel like I'm evidence in some way, especially for, you know, community college goers like us, to know that in fact there are ways to do the things that you love and to make a life for yourself that's constructed out of the things that you're interested in. And so I'm going to start by showing you guys just a little bit of work from when I was your age, and then I'll show you three sort of basic projects, that my sort of most three recent projects, all of which became books, and I'll talk about that a little bit and why I make books as a sort of, I do shows like this, but I also make books because in some ways they feel more egalitarian to me. They go out into the world in a really different kind of way. You know, not so many people walk into galleries and look at work anymore, right? But the books, they're out there, right? And you can find them. In fact, one of my favorite books that I looked for years, this book by Gary Winogrand called The Animals. It was a very funny little paperback. And, you know, I was probably like 20, 21, and I'd been looking for that book since I was like 15 or 16, and it was expensive. Even back then, it was a couple hundred bucks. And I was sleeping at some friend's house, and I rolled over in the morning in the bed, and there it was leveling the bed that I was in, right? And I pulled it out and stuck my paperback under that, and I still have the copy with a little dent in it. And I just love the idea that books travel like that, like they end up in these funny places, and you encounter them in these funny ways. And so that's one of the reasons I'm sort of interested in books. So as I said, I started photographing when I was pretty young, like 12 years old. My parents used to throw us all in this van and drive us all over the country, you know, going to sort of national parks and craft fairs, which were very different animals than they are now. It was where people would sort of set up and be there for like a couple of weeks. They'd set up kilns and blow glass and do all these kinds of things. And my parents are sort of into that. So we'd stop and camp and hang out at these places. And one of the first pictures that I ever made when I was about 14, where I really felt like I got something, was I was at this, with my family at this country fair. I think it was in Minnesota. And I went to this thing, and there was a guy drinking gin out of one of the carny workers drinking water out of a gin bottle, sitting on the edge of the ride while the kids were going around and stuff. And I loved the idea that I could make this photograph that felt like this guy was chugging gin, even though not paying attention to what was going on. And in my head, that picture, as I've remembered it and told this story a number of times, was like a black and white picture, and it was dry and dusty and stuff. Well, I don't know, about 3 years ago I was telling this story, and my mother happened to be in the audience, and she sent me the photograph, which I didn't still have, and it turns out that it was a color picture, right? So before, I've just described it, right? And this was a little 2¼ camera that I sort of stole from my mother and used. I think my parents thought I was sort of nuts, but they just kept giving, because I'm like photographing strangers all the time, you know, I was 12 or 13, and luckily they just kept buying me film, and every summer I'd drop it off at the drugstore and I'd get these little prints back, which I thought I had misplaced, but my mom kept it all, as it turns out. Thank you, Mom.
How did you know it was water?
What's that?
How did you know it was
I made the assumption that it was water. Because I really hope that's not what's going on. But I'm pretty sure water, but yeah. But I always thought it so funny that I thought it was a black and white picture in my head, and it was in fact a color picture. So these are a few pictures. I'm gonna go through some of this really quickly so I can sort of get to the projects that I've been doing, and specifically this last one that I've been doing. So I'll go through some of this really quickly. These are photographs that I was making in college when I was, I went to college at the Rhode Island School of Design after I transferred there from the community college that I'd been in. And I went there, you know, 2 years at the community college and then 3 years at this place, because they never let you do just two, right? You guys will figure that out if you move on. Cost you an extra year. But in fact, it was great. And during this time, I, as I said, I was, you know, from New York and Connecticut, and I would get in my car once, maybe twice a week, and I'd drive to New York and I'd make these photographs on the street in New York City. And then I'd drive back and I'd process that film and make prints and then go back and do it again. You know, it's like back and forth, back and forth. It was kind of crazy, actually. But my life has been sort of like that anyway, sort of transient, running around, lots of driving, right? I love being out there in the world and looking at things. So these photographs were all about trying to sort of cram as much stuff in there as I could. And that picture that I made early on that I told you about, that thing that was about making a photograph that felt like it was true but was actually probably fiction, but my fiction, was a thing that I sort of held on to. So all of my early pictures were about trying to create these kinds of stories, these narratives within the photographs, but using things on the street and putting them together, sometimes not including everybody or everything in the picture, right? Photography is sometimes as much about what you're not including as what you're including in the frame, right? It's this slice, it's different from painting, right? I think a painting is additive, right? We're taking something, we're looking at something, we're transferring it onto the thing, and we're doing that in a way that sort of meets our expectations of what's out there. But photography, you're actually putting a frame, you're actually excising something from the world, right? And I think of it more as a subtractive process than as an additive process. It's as much, again, about what you're not including as what you are including. So in this one, right, it's supposed to be, you know, I'm thinking about women in this picture and this little Cary Grant and Ingrid Bergman, the sort of working woman, the mother, these laughing cops, and then this this sort of women as myth, right, this thing going up in the top piece where there's that sort of statue, right, and trying to cram all that stuff together. This is a photograph made on the Lower East Side in what used to be Little Italy, now that's like about a street, at the San Gennaro Fest. And this picture, I kept coming back to this place because there were all these white people pointing guns at this black guy, right? And I was trying to figure out how to make a photograph of that thing. And so for me, what happened is I cropped the thing in the frame so that it says race there, and then I finally get it so that the kid and the man are both making the same gesture, that repeating gesture of not sort of seeing what the violence of the moment is, right? So these things often don't happen just like that. Sometimes it's about me like going back until I can sort of force something to happen, or waiting for something to happen. And then again, moving my camera around so the pictures look really different. You know, this weird picture. And this is another one, you know, where I sort of play on the sort of black and white film tableau of, like, even in Westerns, right? Everybody good is dressed in white and everybody bad is dressed in black. And then there's all these young girls playing and this guy's sort of reaching in for her while she's sticking her butt out. Of course, it's really, I don't never tell anybody this, right? But this is really just the father going to help her up onto the thing. But I try to make it feel a little bit more nefarious than that. And so these are a few more. Someone paying to see what the object of their affection are, or their dreams are, right? Like trying to find out what's in front of them, and in fact, the thing is maybe right behind them, right? It's my white knight picture. These are photographs made in the mid-80s. Those last photographs were made around 83, 84, 85, 84 and 85. These are made in the sort of later 80s. These are in Los Angeles. Which was a real trip for me. It's a totally different place. I lived there for a number of years, and a totally different place than the East Coast, right? Or even New York in some way. And so much about, you know, body and image and a presentation in some way. And so I really started to get out there and think about it. And my favorite story is, like, I was going back and forth between LA and here when I was making these photographs. And I live in Northampton, which, as we know, is a relatively politically correct town, right? And I'm standing, I'm walking behind a woman, and she's walking up the street, and there's a bunch of construction workers having their lunch. And she's about to walk by them. I go, oh boy, here we go, right? And I can see them sort of like they're going to say something to her. And one of them says, that's a very nice jacket you're wearing today. And she says, thank you. And he turns to his construction buddy worker and goes, that's okay to say, right? And and it cracked me up because then I'm in LA and it's like, you know, those guys, when they do their people, when they do their exercise machines, it's not like in some dark hole somewhere, right? It's like they take a whole storefront and they're right in the front windows doing those things. And everybody's sort of posing in that kind of way. So these photographs were, again, all, so I'm pointing at my computer like you can see it, but all about these sort of body types and, you know, people watching and looking at each other. That's my little Jesus. Doesn't it feel like a Renaissance? And I love this one because that mom's getting all the attention and the daughter's choking her back here in the corner. So these are like these crazy, everybody wears white out there too, by the way. So. I love this photograph because it feels like these older women rubbing their feet in the sand and they feel like young girls, right? Like they could be 12, right? Having this kind of conversation that hasn't stopped over that time period. And I'm sort of changing a lot of things now. I've been jumping back and forth. I'm not going to show you all this stuff, but between cameras, and I'm starting to think a lot about what the skin can feel like in this kind of light, what the body can feel like. And those sort of move me into this other place where I start making photographs in color and start thinking a lot about those issues and sort of slowing things down. These photographs that I'm about to show you are photographs that were made in the late 90s and right up till about early 2000. I think I finished this like in a book of this stuff came out in like 2003, something like that. 2006, I don't know. I can't remember. Something like that. And these were pictures where I started out by going back to places that I'd traveled with my family when I was a kid and really kind of I was traveling there a little bit just to check it out. And of course, I always am photographing, so I started doing that. And what I found there was not what I sort of remembered. And what I started to realize was that our experience of the landscape and how we experience, the woods of the landscape has really changed a lot. And I started thinking about these things as being that no longer are we thinking about our environment, especially as Americans, and how we live in that place as a place that is, you know, if we think about painting, for instance, at the turn of the century, and we think about painters like Asher Durand or, even some of the Hudson Valley painters. You know, there's constantly these figures that are sort of drowned in this vestigial light. They're standing on these pinnacles, and it's like they own this entire landscape, right? It's this idea about myth and religion and all this kind of stuff. But when I get out there, I feel like everything is broken. The environment is broken and marred. The people in it are broken and marred. And none of them are having an experience that feels as religious in some way as it's supposed to be. And everybody seems to be looking for something. At least that's how I sort of pitch it. And so this is not the whole sequence, but it starts out, and also it starts out, which is also sort of a painting motif, that these things sort of go from birth and to death in some way. And the book moves like that. So you won't see all of the pictures, but this is a few of the ones that are early on. So again, this young woman coming down this muddy slide, it's hard to see, but she has a patch over her eye and she's surrounded by these men. And again, so that's sort of a beginning, you know, birthing, spawning pictures. These are what's going on in the end. And again, this idea of being on the abyss or at the edge in some way constantly, standing on the precipice. And I'm looking at tons of painting. In fact, I think that painting probably influenced these pictures maybe more than other photographers than I looked at, that I've been looking at the time. So this is like, I might as well have ripped this right out of an Eakins thing, right? So, and the color palette is hard to see here, but it's deep, but it's muted as well. It's really kind of flat. So much about struggle. It's my little wolf boy. you know, in weird pictures, I'm going into, you know, sometimes I'm showing up at these places. These are made at swimming holes and campgrounds and places like that all over the United States. So I'm just sort of driving around, making all these pictures. And, you know, sometimes I get in there, there's only one or two people. In this case, just two people. And, you know, I can talk about this picture in some ways. It's sort of set up in a specific way. Like when I first got here, they were swimming. I'll give you the story. They were swimming nude in here, right? And I got there, and they kind of got out of the water, asked me what I was doing, and I said something. And I said, "Can I keep photographing you?" They said, "Yeah." And they sort of began to adopt these positions. So she gets up here like Venus, right, onto this rock, and he sort of sits down over here. And I wanted to create. She's looking at him so hard, and I wanted to create a real physical separation. So I just moved my body a little bit so that he is contained within the shadow here and this brick, this stone thing here, right? Which creates a real divide in the frame. So this idea that they're like really separate but then still linked by that gaze that's happening between them. You know, and sometimes you get these real gifts like that, this guy pulling up on his nipple hair, which is so weird.
Yeah. How much do you engage with the people that you photograph? Some, none?
Just depends. Oh, no, a lot, generally. In this case, it's almost impossible not to. Now, I will tell the truth. On this picture, it's one of two where I actually know the people. And this is like 5:30 in the morning at a campground, and I know them. And, you know, he did me the gift of doing that thing, but I don't think he was really paying attention to what he was doing, you know, and the picture kind of rotates on that moment. So in this whole body, there are two pictures. That's one of them. So yeah, sometimes I show up at these places and I start talking to people, and they're like, "Oh, you know, we think because we're doing art that people don't understand what it is that we're doing, but people are pretty savvy and they're pretty visually savvy, especially these days." So I'd say, "Oh, I'm interested in this thing and this and this," and they go, "Oh, there's this great place." And the next thing I know, I'm following this car through these, you know, hills in Kentucky or something, which gets a little weird sometimes, right? Because you're like, "Oh shit, where am I? By myself, I'm following this car full of, you know, teenagers or something." But they always took me to great places, right? No one killed me or anything. Well, that was good. This picture is made, in fact, I should say that picture is made right up the road at the reservoir, at the Greenfield swimming area. And so is that one.
So is this pre 9/11?
Mm-hmm. Some of it. I finished the book in 2003. So I was still photographing, yeah. It's an interesting question.
That there was a change, but I can ask that later.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm thinking a lot about the color. I think my printer thought that I was crazy because on the big prints that I made of these, I couldn't print them myself. These prints I made all myself. But when I was printing, this is also older material. This is film, not digital. So I needed a machine big enough to make the prints the size I wanted to make them. So I was working with this printer, this guy, Ned Gray, a great printer. But he thought I was crazy because I'm saying, "Ned, see the color of that baby, which is like lunch on the table, right? I want that," and this is from the sequence of the book, "I want that color of that skin to match the color of this here, right? So that you make that connection when you move forward," which is kind of grotesque, but it sort of points to how I'm thinking about the color, right? And how about the color as well as the subject moves us through the book. Right? And then on to this sort of broken animal. That's the other person I know in this picture. It's my brother's mother-in-law. It's like the last house on the edge of the desert in Phoenix, right, that they're building out. Literally, it's like the desert right next to that. These weird little spaces that they construct for themselves. Yeah, I love that one. It makes my wife crazy, but I'm always like, that's how I want to go with me and her once sucked right out of the frame, right? No, none of this by yourself crap. So that's my spawning picture. What can I do that? Yeah. And that's my David. You know? And then we get to these things that are a little more vestigial in the end. And I think that's the last picture that I put in here from this group. So the next picture is a group of photographs that I made from around here. I'm going to say something right now, and then I'm not going to say anything about them as I go through. These are photographs that I started thinking about making maybe 20 years ago. I was helping a friend clean out her great uncle's house in Arkansas. I say house, it was really a storefront on the side of this little route, you know, that he had been living in. It's like a three-room shack, essentially, with a big picture plate glass window in the front. And he was kind of, he lived by himself. His wife had died 20 years before, and he was kind of, and he saved everything. Like every staple, used staple, was in a container, like everything. But it was neatly organized. I have to say, it wasn't like crazy. And in the main room, which only had in it, everything else was full. In that room, there was only an old chair, like, you know, Barca lounger chair, a standing ashtray that was also a lamp, and a TV that didn't work in front of the picture window. And next to him, there was a stack of cardboard that he had been using as a journal. It was about the height of the armchair. And I walked over and picked it up. They were the insides of Weedy boxes that he'd been using to write as a journal. And on there, he had written, and this went the whole way through, he'd written, I'm just going to make it start with a date, September 21st. And then he wrote the word nothing. September 22nd, nothing. September 23rd, nothing. And this went on for years. Like, every once in a while, I'd be like, hitchhike to church today, right? Things like that. And I was blown away, right? I was like, oh my God, this is like possibly the saddest thing I've ever encountered, but also an amazing thing, because that he wrote that thing down at the end of the day meant that he believed there would be something tomorrow. And that kind of, that idea of hope, right, in the midst of that stuff stuck with me in a pretty big way. Now, that's just how I perceive the thing, right? Let's face it, it's all about me. But so, you know, that's just sort of how I perceived that moment. And I thought for years about, like, how am I going to make either a group of pictures about that or even a single picture about that? And I went as far as to start collecting my kids' cereal boxes, right, thinking that someday I was going to have some, get my stepfather to write with his broken, bad handwriting, you know, when he was in his 80s, that same information on there, and then make a photograph on it. And then finally, it occurs to me, my brother is an auctioneer, and I started going with him to some of the places that he was cleaning out, these houses that he was cleaning out. Quite often they were places that had been abandoned for all kinds of reasons, lots of times death. And I started going into those places and photographing what was left. These are those photographs. And I think these pictures I made, you know, the last body of work was a book. It ended up being that way, but I didn't really think about it that way when I started. When I started this, I knew it was going to be a book, and I knew it was going to be small, and this thing that was intimate, and sort of put together in a way that felt like a box, right, where something was found, and that you would open it up and discover things inside, much the way I discovered those things in the houses, or by opening boxes up when I was with my brother. And so I tried to get all this stuff in here. The pictures are supposed to be looked at quietly and intimately, so I'm going to say nothing, and then we'll just go through and look at the pictures. If you have questions about them later, I can certainly address those things. And most of these were made 50 miles from here, within a 50-mile radius. And that's the last one of those.
Did you do any arranging of those images? Are the articles in the pictures, or is it just as you found them?
Sometimes I did, but not often. You have to, it's kind of, you know, it's all there. There's not a lot. You know, one time, I think the picture, that one with the gun right there, everything else was like that, and the gun was on the floor. And I picked it up and put it up top. So I'll do things like that. That's like the most I do, though. Not that I have any problem with that, by the way. Because especially in these pictures, I'm trying to tell a story. I'm not really, you know, I understand that it's like, it's not the world's truth, it's kind of my truth, my understanding of these places and what the things feel like. And yes, I'm talking about some things that are, I mean, I'm pointing towards truth, and I use the sort of motif of photography to sort of confuse you a little bit, because we kind of try to believe photographs, which is maybe an error. And I still have questions about, like, what's real? Like, what is real? Like, what's fact, right? I believe these are truth, about truth in some way, but they are kind of my truth in some sense, or how I understand the world. And I think that's what kind of makes it interesting. When I look at other people's work, I think a lot about, and it depends. Some people's work, you look at it and it's all about them, and some people, it doesn't look like it's about them at all, but in fact, that was the impetus, like how they saw the world. Even though it's more covert, is much about how we understand that stuff. And so the way I think about art is like, I'm my gift to you, you're your gift to me, right? Everything's been done. The only thing you have is who you are, where you came from, the way you understand. You know, we all walk around with our own little colored glass. And I think that in that way, when we're looking through that colored glass, we're reflecting the world around us. You know, and there's no more, you know, I mean, people say this all the time, but right now, I think there's almost no more important thing than us reflecting the world around us and thinking about what that looks like. A time when many of us can feel, because of the sort of political climate, regardless of what side of the fence you're on, many of us can feel voiceless and helpless and without agency in some way. And I think one of the great things about art is that it gives us all of those things. It supplies all of those things. It allows us to examine ourselves. It allows us to examine the world. It allows us to put stuff out into the world so that those voices individually and collectively can begin to talk about who we are culturally and, you know, maybe even specifically as Americans, right? And then as humanitarians, right? So I think those are like really important things to be thinking about, especially if I was a young person making work or on the edge of thinking about whether I wanted to be an artist. I just think there's no better time than right now. That's my preachy sermon.
It's interesting that this work is called Elegy.
So it came out of that work, and I'll start talking about that now, which is, this is the last body of work that I just finished. This book just came out in December. I did it very quickly. Probably the quickest thing that I've ever done. Just when I was finishing the last book, which was in 2012, I was out photographing in Pennsylvania and upstate New York, Massachusetts a little bit, and I was there looking for other abandoned houses, abandoned spaces where I could find some semblance of who was living in those spaces as an extension of what I was doing. But what I ended up realizing that I'm in these towns, I'm listening to like the radio while I'm driving around, the last election is happening, and all I'm hearing is a conversation about the middle and the upper class. And I'm driving through these towns, which used to be kind of the exception, and no longer are the exception, where everything is gone. The local economy is gone, there are no jobs, there's a half a mile strip of town where there's maybe three stores open. It's the dollar store, the liquor store, and the tattoo parlor, like the only brick and mortar things left, right? And then I'm meeting people, and I'm starting to get pissed, right? And I'm listening to this conversation. I'm like, these people are not remotely part of the political conversation. And of course, we see what happens, you know, with the election of Trump, because many of those people who were disenfranchised, sometimes for generations, rightly were angry and voted in a specific kind of way. Right? And so I'm making these photographs, which was torture for me because I really, you know, I don't really think of myself as a classic documentary photographer, but I was angry. So I struggled between doing something that was really political but something that was also poetic. Like, those two were the two things that I was fighting with the whole time I was making the pictures. I wanted them to be political, but I wanted them to be open enough so that people could come in and make them their own, right? That's, I think, how people get to stuff. That's how people start asking questions, is not being yelled at, not being told something, not making a picture that's really simple, that shows somebody broken and I don't know, right? So I tried to be more subtle than that. This is a photograph that I made. That's the picture. That's a picture that Tom Young, some of you guys may know, Tom and I were out photographing together, and Tom made this photograph of me making that picture. The upper right-hand corner is the thing I photographed, right? And I have this little platform that I stand on top of my car to get elevation sometimes. Yes?
It seemed to me from what you were just saying that when you had brought a project to a conclusion, then that energy arose in you to start something new. Did it seem like that to you?
Yeah, I mean, yes. I mean, I think it's a combination of things. I don't actually usually have projects in my head. I don't say, I'm going to go out and do this. It's not how I work. It's how lots of people work. It's just not how I work. I photograph a lot, and I'll be out places like with this. I was out, I was looking at stuff, and this other thing started. And I had finished this other thing, but this other thing started to happen. And in fact, when I looked back from even the few months before when I'd been there, it had already started to happen. I just hadn't made sense of it yet. And then it took me 3 years. I made sure this thing was done by the time, you know, this presidential election was done. I wanted it. I wanted that to happen. I, of course, had no idea that there would be all this sort of turmoil and stuff. I couldn't have known that. I just knew that something was amiss, right? That there was a kind of thing boiling under the surface and no one was really paying attention to that thing. And so my idea was to sort of then, and I had to work through that. I probably made more pictures than I've ever made before on a project. My poor wife, we got kids and everything. I'm gone all the time, right, for this thing. I'm like photographing those things. You know, I'm out photographing. I'm coming back. To make this book of 84 pictures, which is a pretty big book, there were probably, Nick seen, there's probably four stacks of pictures this high, right, of like 11 by 4. There was a lot, right? And to then shape, and then it became a very different thing, shaping that into something that was its own. So these are the photographs, and again, it's not all of the 83 pictures. They're just photographs I was making in these places. And evidently, it's just going to start going by itself now. I don't know why that's happening, but we'll let it keep going. It's too fast. So these pictures are mostly, almost all made, a little bit in Massachusetts, mostly in upstate New York, Pennsylvania, a little bit of West Virginia, and a little bit of Ohio. Most of the places that I'm traveling to are towns that were had always been economically affected as things like fossil fuel, trees, coal, paper, and farming. As those things were sort of going under in those towns, the recession of 2008. Sort of was the final nail in the coffin of a lot of these towns, right? It did not leave much there. And it used to be, again, I drive a lot, and it used to be there were, these towns existed. They certainly existed in Pennsylvania and around the other country. But again, they were more of the exception in some ways, unless you were in Appalachia, right? They were more of the exception. And these just, you don't have to drive, 20 minutes in any direction from almost any place in the United States to find somewhere that looks like this. And it's really, we think of depressed. I really can't sort of explain. You can buy a house in some of these towns for $6,000. I'm not talking about a little house, like a three-story big house, Victorian house for $6,000, right? It is a completely different kind of economy that is going on in other parts. And that separation of that kind of economy is so different from the next jump up, right? People live in houses that they've had for four generations and they can't move and sell. So they're sort of stuck. So there's a lot of conversations with people and research went into this project as well, more than I usually do. And you'll see as we go through the pictures that I did this thing, there's not a lot of sky in these pictures, right? The idea was to sort of compress the space this way and this way so that it felt like there wasn't a lot of room to move in the spaces and in the places, right? And the way that things are broken up like this, we see, like a photograph like that, and then a photograph like that, we're seeing sort of the stripped down version of the architecture. We sometimes see three or four generations of what has happened with the architecture. The original building, then covered with asphalt, right? Then covered with, vinyl siding, right? This idea, and as they start to fall apart, we can see that history in them. And we can see that history in some of the same bodies that we're looking in there, right? A kind of age or degradation of the body that seems through overuse in some way. Like even the trees and stuff, it gets pretty bleak. But when I was making these pictures, I had in my head a lot this quote by sort of writer, political activist, Cornel West, and he talks about all of us being prisoners of hope in some way. This idea that it's one of our most powerful traits, but it's also the thing that can keep us from moving, right? It can paralyze us, because we think that thing about thinking there's going to be something better next day, without actually taking action, there might not be something better, right? And that there's this way in which we thrive because we have that hope, but it also debilitates us as well in some ways. And so I have that in my mind a lot as I'm making these pictures. And I'm making real different kinds of pictures of young people than I am of older people. You know, the idea of a beginning as opposed to somebody being closer to the end, right? Like, what does that look like? Yeah, Budge.
I didn't hear the last part you said, but can I assume then that the effete nature of this work, where you're going and where you're traveling, that with the election, et cetera, you don't see any change in the future, and these villages have got to be completely revamped to be something else?
Yeah,
you're not going to get back from your conversation the old fossil fuels.
No, they're not getting that stuff back. Even
though they were promised it's possible.
Yeah, I mean, if I get, it's not. And certainly not in that part of the world. If at best, I mean, I'm doing all the homework on this stuff, right? So at best, for coal is already the little sister right now of gas, right? Gas is where the money is. Somebody's got to be the loser. It will be coal. And coal, the best they're expecting is a 5% kick. That will create 6,500 jobs, and 6,000 of those jobs will go to Montana. The others will go to some middle states. None will go to Pennsylvania and Ohio. And the reason is it's harder and more expensive. They're not tooled up correctly, and it's harder and more expensive to get that stuff out of there.
So I was a little angry with you for documenting the past.
It's a little.
But you mention in your statement,
yep,
of the possible future with this recent election, but that isn't going to, it's useless kind of hope, a possibility. Well, and those.
I don't know, and I see, this is the thing where I find myself getting right in more to the political conversation and less about the sort of poetic, but, you know, for me, it's. For me, it was about the struggle, right? It's about people who are struggling and their sort of ability to have hope, their ability to actually make change in their lives in some ways, even in the face of pretty difficult odds. But more about, again, this idea of persistence that I was sort of, and that, for me, I know it doesn't always feel that way in the pictures, but for me, the people feel in some ways heroic, and I purposely don't make them always feel heroic, but I don't make them feel necessarily broken either, right? The idea is to sort of keep them in this place that is real. It's been very interesting. I mean, this book, it was not released, the whole book part was not released until the end of December, but all the advance copies were out there earlier than that, before the election, in fact. I flew to Paris to do this book launched in Paris at this thing called Perifoto, and I flew there the night of the election. So I got off the plane, and I knew who our president was. And then the book released the next day, and it completely changed the way that people perceived that book the day before. Because I'd been doing some of these signings and things and having conversations, doing talks, and there was a total change in the way that people perceived it. In the beginning, People were human, and they were thinking about these people and their struggle, and again, the sort of persistence, the things I was hoping, these kinds of persistence of both of hope and action. And the next day, you know, my fellow liberals, who I you know, continually sort of lose faith in sometimes, my fellow liberals were like, those fucking people voted for Trump, those fucking Trumpers, you know? And I'm like, you can't paint them all with that brush, right? You know, many, many rich people voted for Trump, right? You know, 56% of white women voted for Trump, right? These are the real numbers. But again, we get into the sort of political thing. But the reality is, what is so interesting for me is that me starting out to do this one thing, and then the way the book gets received shifts completely because the political climate shifts, right? And that becomes pretty interesting as well. Right. And the way that Europeans saw it, the book, as a compared to the way that Americans see the book, too. Also very different. Yeah. Yeah, you know, it's a weird thing because especially in France, everybody was really worried, is and was worried about if Trump got elected, that would pave the way for Marie Le Pen, who is their right-wing version, I think probably more right-wing than Trump is, and more nationalist in some ways. So that was a huge concern, which of course is now, it is fueling that as we see, and Brexit happened, 2 weeks before, and you know, so there's all these kinds of things going on. And so there was, you know, and then I'm you know, we're in Europe, and there's, you know, socialist medicine, and, you know, people get taken care of in a different kind of way than they get taken care of here. And so that was much part of the conversation, like, we don't understand why, you know, this looks like this in what is supposedly one of the richest countries in the world, right? Like, why is there this discrepancy between these sort of economic stratas, right? So that was much of the conversation. So are there any other questions about the pictures or anything like that? We've got a few minutes left, I think. I teach at Amherst College. That's one of the ways I do it. But yes, I also apply all the time for grants, fellowships, anything that comes down the pike that I think can sort of help me out to make the work. It's expensive to do it. Yeah. It's expensive to do it, and I'll just page back and let that go through again.
That's another way.
You know, I make these books, but that just costs money. there's no way, and I guess I'll talk a little bit about the books in a way, because they're two different things, you know. As my friend Henry Hornstein says, these things are like expensive business cards, right?
And I feel like, you know, you gotta raise money to make the books. They sell for a lot of money, but you know what's left in this for me every time? It's a $55 book, $1.98. I'm never making any money back off of this thing. I can't tell you how much it cost me to drive, just in gas over the last 4 years. Forget about all the rest, you know, prints, inks, all that kind of stuff. You're never recouping in that way. I do make money selling prints, but not that often and not that much. Right? So I'm lucky that I have this teaching gig, right? And I have a good teaching gig. For years, I did the itinerant thing, you know. In my worst year, I was teaching in 4 schools in 3 states, 800 miles a week, right? But that was my fault, because everybody kept saying, you don't have enough experience. I said, okay, I just took every job that came. And I just did it. And that's what I meant about working hard, right? You work hard, and then finally that thing pays off. I teach at a good place, got this, you know, and that stuff helps me. So I should say the books are really heavily designed too, and they're meant, you know, when I made this book, it was meant to, I wanted the pictures to be big, and they were made in 2 different aspect ratios, so they're meant so they float across the page, like this way and this way. And my publisher convinced me I would never put, my whole life I said I'd never put a picture across the gutter and divide it in that way. I dropped my mic. Oh, I unplugged my mic. But in this case, we came up with a binding that would allow the book to sit dead flat. Right? And
that allowed me to sort of go across that gut and sort of move the pages back and forth. And the thing is designed sort of like the buildings are designed. I took this picture that sort of wraps three quarters of the way around, and then the binding, the cardboard is exposed raw, the way the stuff is coming off the sides of the building. So there was like a lot of design going went into this book. You're welcome. Go ahead.
The book seems a little heavy to me, the printing of it, compared to some of the things I'm seeing on the wall. And I know that the project before that was film, and this is digital. I'm just wondering what challenges or discoveries or what, you know, presented itself as you were making that transition. And palette and, you know, all those. I know you really care about all that stuff.
Yeah, it was different. Like moving from film was really different. I did that with that book. That's the first thing I did in digital, this book here, and then this one, and then this work. Yeah, it's just a different animal. You know, it's like moving from, and it's really different. It's like moving from oil to gouache or something. You know, the tools are different. Everything goes on the paper differently. It's just, it's all different, right? And some of the skills are the same, but some of them are different, and you have to think about that stuff. And in some ways, you know, there was such a limited amount of things to do, especially in color printing, with film.
C-print, yeah.
Yeah, C-print. There was a limited amount of control that you had. Now it's like anything. What do you want to add? You want to change the color of this? You want to balance everything? I fight pretty hard against that. There's like mixed color palette in these sometimes. You know, there's warm and cool light coming in at the same time. I love that stuff, so I tried to hold that stuff in. I am shooting a lot on days, with the exception of a couple of the pictures where it's slightly overcast, so the light is more like omni-light and everything comes down a little bit. Like I didn't, you know, that's like the brightest picture in the book is that, and on purpose in some ways, is that young boy standing in the light. And that looks like a clock, right? I mean, it's, you know, of these young men sort of standing around there, and their age sort of moves a little bit too. And, you know, and the idea was, you know, looking at that compared to, you know, the photograph of...
Was the orange?
No, they were playing football and it stopped. That's in Kenajahari.
And he just looked at you.
Yeah, he's not quite looking at me, but yeah, I think I got two pictures off there, you know. And he was just amazing. It was really contrasty. It's really hard to print, actually. Like a terrible. These are the two ends of the spectrum for me, in some way. You know, again, that young body right there. So, you know, on purpose, I go from that house, which is sort of collapsing on itself, right, to that guy who's sort of collapsing in some way. And he's the sort of counterpoint to those young guys, right, to that picture of the dead bird, right? And the blue takes us through, right, carries us through. So
35 millimeter or
I'm using two different cameras. One of them is a 35 millimeter digital camera, full frame SLR. It's not an SLR, it's a rangefinder. But and the other one, I use an old Hasselblad, like my old Hasselblad from the 80s that I have a P45, phase one P45 digital back on that I bought used, which was ungodly expensive. It cost twice as much as my very crappy car. You know, but I did, you know, it's interesting because when I decided to do that, I had just done my taxes for the year before. I'd been thinking about it for a while, and I did my taxes. It was like, I spent $12,000 last year on film and processing, which is pretty intense, and the back was $13,000. So I was like, all right, I don't ever have to buy film again or process the stuff, and I've been using it for 5 years or something.
So these are both cameras?
These are all digital cameras.
They're both great size and the
medium format. Yeah, they're two different aspect ratios. Yeah. Yeah, some are sort of more squat. The house over there is a 30 by 40, and the one next to it's a 30 by 45.
So what is your process in 1 minute or less?
Drive. I have two rules. One of them's pretty new. Is that, and it's the most exciting part for me. One is I read recently a letter that Jackson Pollock's father wrote to him, and when he was sort of getting going, and the main gist of it was, the sentence I remembered was, be awake to the world, right? Be awake to the world, right? So that's my one rule, right? is like I try to be, especially when I'm out photographing, just be out, like really paying attention, pay attention to what's happening. And then my other rule is recently just trust myself, right? Stop stopping myself, which we all do, right? And my process really is about discovery. I love being out there. I start making things. I heard Lee Friedlander say this thing, which really annoys me, but at the same time, I kind of understand. Somebody asked him, he's really prolific, unbelievably prolific. How do you come up with all these projects? He says, I don't have projects. I make pictures. I put the picture, I like a picture, I put it in a box, box gets full, that's a project, right? Now, it's kind of a jerky statement, right? Because it assumes that you're just doing great all the time, right? Which is not how we work. But on the other hand, it is sort of how I work, right? Is that I go out there and I start collecting and building. I have interests over here and I never throw anything away, right? Like over here, I've kind of got this on the back burner and some of them get legs and some of them don't. And if I really get into something, then I start moving, right? And then I start looking and I edit. I look at my pictures a lot. There's always stuff on the wall. I have trouble looking at things on the computer, so I print tons of stuff and put it on the wall and I live with it and I move it around. And then I realize I need more of something or I don't have enough of this and I keep going, right? And sometimes it changes, what I thought I was doing changes completely by the time that I'm done. And sometimes I look at it 5 years later and I go, oh, I thought I was doing this, but I might have been doing this, right? That was more than 1 minute.
How do you choose what
to do? It's funny, sometimes, mostly it's just driving, right? And looking. And sometimes that means nothing. And sometimes you don't get anything, it can be very frustrating. But sometimes, I hardly ever go on the interstate unless I know I'm I'm going to Pennsylvania this week and I know I'm gonna go to this one place. And then I could just drive a lot. And sometimes I'll pick a hotel and I'll just like go from there. And sometimes I'll drive and then, you know, I get another 4 hours away or something. And sometimes I swear to God, I go, you know, Freetown, New York. Yeah, I'm going there, right? Like sometimes it's just the name, you know, Shamokin. Yeah, I'm going there, right? Canajoharie. There's gonna be like Shamokin's gonna have a picture, right? So sometimes it is just like that. You know, and things have changed. It used to be just drive, drive, drive. Now there's like Google Maps, right? And I literally can, if I'm bored at night, it almost never works out, but at night I'm back in the hotel, I'm on satellite view, like looking at towns and seeing if it looks what it looks like there. It almost never works out, but yeah.
The feeling of the print from the display there.
Oh, thank you.
Which I generally don't see on the digital.
Yeah. It's hard, you know, it's hard. It's getting the, on these prints, there's a couple of things that happen, some on purpose and some by accident, but one of the things is keeping the sharpness down, like really finding what you're sharpening and how much you're sharpening it. You know, these already look, you know, if you look at my C prints, these are 5 times sharper than my C prints could ever be, right? So, but those things also feel a way that these are never going to feel, even if I dumb them down to try and look like sea prints. They're, again, just they're different animals. The other thing is this thing that happened by accident. This show came from my gallery at Carol and Sons in Boston, and there was an accident at the framer where they put in the really expensive glass instead of the other glass, and which ended up costing me just a stupid amount of money. But man, it's like there's no glass, right? So you're not seeing yourself or any reflection, and I think that helps a lot. To sort of be able to get right in there, which is maddening because I don't ever want to spend that much money on a piece of glass again. And I wish I didn't have to, but it was an accident. Like literally the gallery guy called me up the day he was hanging the show before the opening and said, I just got the bill and they used the wrong glass. They look great, but it's another blah, blah, blah. I was like, oh, you know. And then, you know, there's a 6 month long fight about who owes that money, right?
But now you're gonna want that glass.
Well, now the problem is I'm like, I kinda, yeah, but I can't. It's. What's that?
It's fantastic.
It's amazing, but you know that size is almost a full sheet of glass, and a sheet. And I think that actually is plexi, not glass, but it's this Optima stuff. It's $400 a sheet. You know, it's just stupid, and it pisses me off. You know, an interesting conversation that I had with my gallery guys originally, I just wanted to take the prints, mount them, and put them on the wall. Because I had I don't know if it's a silly thing or not, but I'm like, I'm photographing in all of these places where you can buy a house for $6,000, and I'm spending that on framing. That seems wrong to me. And, but I couldn't, you know, for the gallery guy, it's a business, right? And he's like, either we do it this way or we don't hang it. So I got a choice to make, right? In this case, maybe I chose the wrong thing. I don't know. But anyway, I got to have the show, right? I got to get it out there, right? Yeah, hopefully. Yeah, hopefully it gets out there and stuff. And, you know, I am, like, right now scheduling more shows at, you know, usually I have shows at these sort of, you know, like, bigger, I'm hitting the sort of community college route in, you know, through the places that I've been, so the work gets out in there to the community more and arts organizations in those places, so it gets out in the community more than it would otherwise. So I don't, and I'm really interested in what those conversations are going to look like once I get there and the people who, in the places where I'm making the pictures, actually start sort of talking back to them a little bit. We'll see what that looks like.
So,
what's that?
What do you teach at MS College?
All kinds of stuff. I teach, occasionally I'll teach a drawing class, but mostly I'm, you know, photo and, you know, like a 1, 2, and 3. Sometimes I teach this course where I put, you know, 10 students in a van. We pick a place and for, you know, 6 months we photograph that place and then we make a book at the end. So all kinds of things. This next year I'm teaching a freshman foundation course that's supposed to be writing intensive, but it's me, so it's going to be a text. It's going to be an art protest and what did I title it? Like art protest and propaganda or something. And it's going to be about text and image. So that's where I'll get the text part in. But really, I think they need more of a visual. I think young people at college need a visual literacy course as much as they need a good, solid writing course these days. Since most of the information they're getting is visual, it's important that they know how to take that stuff apart and speak that language. Thanks, folks.